Okay, good afternoon. It's Commissioner Rothstein for the afternoon session. We're going to start with item 11, which is a bid approval for a term contract on utility locating services. I believe Andy and Mike should be on. There's Andy.
That's not, that's here for Mike.
Okay. So who's going to start it?
Okay, so we're requesting your approval to award a term contract for utility locating services of the county's water and sewer infrastructure within the Freedom Districts, the town of Hampstead. It's Bark Hill and Pleasant Valley, and it's going to be to Procom ELS LLC, located in Baltimore, Maryland. We received five bids, and they were the lowest bid. And based on the schedule of prices and recent annual volumes of locating services, the call request, it's expected the annual usage of this term contract will not exceed $75,000. It is within the budget.
Gentlemen, the Bureau of Utilities has locating responsibilities for approximately 136 miles of water main, 149 miles of sewer main, as well as the water and sewer laterals that connect approximately 11,000 customers to our service systems in Freedom, Hampstead, Pleasant Valley, and Bark Hill. Historically, the locating responsibilities for water and sewer infrastructure have been assigned to the Water Distribution Division. This division consists of only five employees. While these duties were manageable when the program began in fiscal year 07, the volume of calls has steadily increased. In recent years, the Bureau has averaged approximately 5,500 normal hours locating requests, as well as 150 emergency after-hour requests annually. This equates to approximately 21 normal hours locates per workday, an average of three emergency locates per week. So this has evolved into a full-time responsibility with after-hours, weekend, and holiday responses that is restricting my staff's ability to respond to system needs, even more so now as maintenance requirements have increased with an aging infrastructure. In view of this, the Bureau requested funding for contractual locating services as part of the FY21 budget process. This request was supported and approved. The Bureau then implemented a trial program in March of this year to determine the feasibility of a contractual approach. The trial program moved forward with excellent response levels and acceptable costs. With these results in hand, the Bureau then requested bids for contractual servicing of these responsibilities. As Tina said, five firms responded. Procom ELS did submit the best value bid and is performing similar work in Baltimore County, Baltimore City, and in Northern Virginia. With the unit prices submitted by Procom, the overall cost associated with this effort will stay well within budget. The Bureau's opinion that contracting this work to a firm specializing in locating services with a fully dedicated and redundant staff is an efficient and cost-effective approach that will allow county personnel to focus on maintaining and servicing the public water systems.
Andy, have we ever used them before?
We have not, Commissioner Weaver, but they are doing very similar work to our East in Baltimore County, as well as Baltimore City, and one jurisdiction in Northern Virginia.
I'll move the Board of Commissioners award a term contract to the utility locating services, the county's water and sewer infrastructure to Procom ELS LLC of Baltimore, Maryland.
Second.
Okay, I got a motion in a couple seconds. Obviously, no discussion. All in favor? Okay, unanimous. Now let's move on to the installation of these water meter vaults on Hammond Ave and Barley Road.
Tina, you're on mute.
Okay, so we're requesting your approval to award two contracts for the installation of water meter vaults on Hammond Avenue. There's 26 residents, and Barley Road, 35 residents. It's within the Freedom District service area to Mid-Atlantic Utilities in the overall amount of $86,175. These awards were competitively bid on a term contract. The locations were bid as two separate groupings to generate interest and competitive bidding and pricings. And the bid amount is within the adopted budget, so no additional funds would be necessary.
Gentlemen, some of the statements I'm going to make for item 12 also apply to the next item, item 13. This project is part of an ongoing system-wide upgrade from indoor meters to the current standard of remote read outdoor meters and vaults. It is very similar to projects that I have presented to the board for approval over the past year or so. The Freedom Service Area has approximately 9,100 meter residential users. With this project and item 13 following, we will have approximately 7,780 users fully upgraded to current standards with 1,320 left. As Tina said, this item does include two separate groupings of roadways, Hammond Avenue and Barley Road. Mid-Atlantic Utilities was the low bidder on both of these groupings. And as previously stated, this is a proactive approach to grouping meters by street or area for cost and time savings, rather than continuing with the previously used individual task approach. And this has resulted in substantial cost savings. The average cost for these two roadways is $1,410 per unit, as compared to the average cost of approximately $2,500 per unit, as occurred in the past. And again, once the meter vaults are installed, county staff follows up with the meter installation itself.
Andy, when is the expectation of the 1,320 that are left? What is the timeline?
I would estimate 5 to 7 years. And the reason I'm saying that Commissioner Rothstein, is the more challenging residential units are the ones that are left. There's many, many townhouse units that are left. We're going to have to really get a game plan put together to attack those in the best manner. The easier homes have all been completed.
Okay, thanks.
I make the motion that the Board of Commissioners award two contracts for the installation of the water meter bolts on Hammond Avenue and Barley Road to Mid-Atlantic Utilities Incorporated, the amount of $86,175.
Second.
Okay, got a motion second. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor? Okay, item 13.
Tina, you're on mute again.
We're requesting your approval to award three contracts for the installation of water meter vaults on Bridgeport Court. There's 6 residents, Hammond Court, 7 residents, and Barley Drive. There's 4 residents. It's within the Freedom District service area, and we're going to award it to HTI contractors in the overall amount of $28,915. And these awards will be made on a term contract, which we currently have. These locations were bid as 3 separate groupings to generate interest and competitive pricing, and the bid amount is within the adopted budget.
Commissioners, just to make sure that you understand our approach with this, my staff does make it very clear to our contractors as we bid these that they will be awarded to the lowest bidder on an individual road basis. So we are not playing games with the contractors by any means. Highland Turf or HTI out of Finksburg was the low bidder on each of these 3 groupings. The average cost for these 3 roadways is approximately $1,700 per unit as compared to the $2,500 average cost incurred in the past. And the reason for the slightly higher cost of item 13 versus item 12 units are 6 of the 17 of these locations are located within concrete driveways. So additional attention must be made to those. And again, once the meter vaults are installed, my staff follows up with the meter installation itself.
Okay, I make the motion the Board of Commissioners award 3 contracts for installation of water meter vaults on Bridgeport Court, Hammond, and Barley Drive to HTI contractors in the overall amount of $28,915.
Second.
Okay, any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor? Got unanimous, I think. There we go. Now let's look at buying cars. Thank you, Tina.
Thank you very much, Commissioner.
Andy.
Okay, so we're requesting your approval to award the purchase of a 2019 Dodge Caravan to Mobility Works in the amount of $41,061.18. This vehicle will be used by Carroll Transit. The bid amount is within the adopted budget.
Good afternoon, Commissioners. We're looking to replace the 2012 Dodge Caravan with approximately 106,000 miles. This is a handicap accessible van that will be used by CTS for veteran transportation. Due to the current vehicle's age, condition, and mileage, we're requesting that the vehicle be replaced.
Hey, Keith, was 2012 also handicap accessible?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, I believe four of the veterans' vans are handicapped accessible, and they have two larger vans, which are both also handicapped accessible, but which seat more people.
Right, okay.
With that, I move the Board of Commissioners award the purchase of the 2019 Dodge Caravan to Mobility Works in the amount of $41,061.18.
Second.
You couldn't use 18 cents?
I'll take it out of your pocket. Okay, I got a motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor? Okay, unanimous, I think. There we go. Let's talk about grinders. Tina, you're up.
We're requesting your approval to award the purchase of a new Vermeer Stump Grinder SC382 to Vermeer Mid-Atlantic Incorporated in the amount of $27,940. This purchase is awarded through a Sourcewell contract, which is competitively bid process. The bid amount is within the budget.
Commissioners, this stump grinder will be used by the Bureau of Facilities. Currently, facilities estimates they have about 200 stumps that require grinding. They're constantly removing and replanting trees. When they rent one of these, it's approximately $3,000 a month, and they end up renting one several times a year. So they feel that this purchase will, in the long run, save us money.
Looks like it should be a quite massive stump grinder. Is it like medium, large? And in the realm of stump grinders, where does it fall?
Commissioners, we did some research on this stump grinder, and it can do anything from 2 inches round caliber all the way up to 24 inches round in caliber. So it can manage any stumps, any trees that we come across that either fell during a storm, where we can do the cleanups.
Your arm for bear, this will cover the full spectrum.
That is correct.
Well, then I move that the Board of Commissioners award the purchase of a new Vermeer Stump Grinder SC382 to Vermeer Mid-Atlantic Inc. in the amount of $27,940.
Second.
Okay. Got a motion and second. Any discussion? Seeing, hearing none. All in favor? Okay, we got unanimous. Let's go to item 16 and talk about purchase of a Highland 4,000 gallon used oil tank.
We're requesting your approval to award the purchase of a Highland 4,000 gallon used oil tank to Clean Fuels Associates located in Glen Burnie, Maryland in the amount of $43,495. 51 cents. The amount is within the adopted budget and no additional funds would be necessary.
This is just to store used oil, right?
Correct. This is to store the used oil out of the maintenance center for fleet management. It's a 4,000 gallon tank, as Tina said. This is replacing a tank that is approximately 30 years old. Upon routine inspection, we discovered it had a small leak. We were able to get it emptied out, the small leak cleaned up, start getting prices on replacing it. And this cost will include bringing us up to code, which we are currently not at since this was installed approximately 30 years ago.
Is this underground?
No, it is above ground.
Double wall?
Yes, double wall. Current code requires a concrete pad, as now it's sitting on asphalt. And they also require an overfill shutoff so that we cannot overfill the tank.
Wow, seems like a lot for a 4,000 gallon tank.
I think a lot of the money is going into the prep to get us up to code, the concrete pad, the overfill protection. They're required now to have a ladder so you can get to the top of the tank, which we don't have. We had two, we contacted four vendors. We ended up with two estimates. The other estimate was 53,000. So we did go with the lowest vendor, and the other two were no response.
Okay. I'll move the Board of Commissioners award the purchase of a Highland 4,000 gallon used oil tank to Clean Fuels Associates in the amount of $43,495.51. Got to lose the 51 cents, guys.
Second.
There is no sense in this, but anyway, I have got a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Seeing, hearing none, all in favor? Okay, we got all thumbs up, unanimous. Let's talk about bulk road salt. Go for it, Tina.
We're requesting your approval to award the contract for bulk road salt to Morton Salt in the amount of $51.86 per ton delivered. The Bureau of Roads operation uses the salt for road de-icing and treatment during inclement weather. The annual amount used will vary depending on weather. This purchase is awarded through the State of Maryland contract, which is competitively bid process, and the amount is within the adopted budget.
Okay, most of this, I assume, is in transportation. And what does the salt actually cost per ton?
The salt per ton is $51.86.
You're muted, Commissioner.
Dick, you're muted.
Oh, what does the salt actually cost, and what is the transportation cost in this? But they bid it all together. It is
bid it all together. It's the one the State of Maryland contract, and that's the part. I don't think they break down delivery.
Okay, I'm assuming salt is probably less than $10 a ton or something like that, and the rest is probably transportation delivery.
I see that 51.86 per ton. How is that compared to last year? Is this going up, stabilized, going down? Is there a track record of that call?
I can answer that, Commissioners. It's actually lower. Last year we paid over $63 a ton, and this $51 is a great price.
Well, then that's good news. Thank you. With that said, I moved that the Board of Commissioners award the contract for bulk road salt to Morton Salt in the amount of 51.86 per ton delivered.
Second. And Tina, I didn't mean to throw you off on that.
No problem.
Okay, I got a motion second. Any further discussion? Seeing, hearing none, all in favor? See four thumbs. Good to go. Unanimous. Okay, let's talk about 2019 Gradle XL 4100 Tech S. Tina, you're up.
Okay, we're requesting your approval to award the purchase of a 2019 Gradle XL 4100-5 to Elliott and Franz Incorporated in the amount of $355,500. This is a sole source purchase. The bid amount is within the adopted budget.
Commissioners, we're looking to replace a 2005 Gradle XL3100. The machine we currently have has been experiencing mechanical issues the past couple of years and has been costing us money. We're also looking to upgrade to a slightly larger machine, 4100, to match the other current machines that the Roads Department has. We're going to buy this machine off lease. So it will be a 2019 with 475 hours. We're going to trade in our old machine for $22,500.
Mr. Vogel, how wide of a bucket is one then?
I would have to check the specs to find. It's not a huge bucket because it's used more for digging and grading. It's not like a loader bucket. I want to say 48 inches, but I would have to check the specs on that for you.
When did we purchase the other one? We had one not long ago, the last couple of years.
It was either a year or two ago. We did the same thing. We purchased the 4100 off lease. So it was a slightly used machine, but they do give you a better price.
Okay, Okay, do I hear a motion?
Move the Board of Commissioners award the purchase of a 2019 Grade All XL 4105 to Elliott and France in the amount of $355,500 and no cents.
Second.
That is right, Commissioner Weaver. You have no sense. Any other further discussion? Any seeing none? All in favor? I see four thumbs. Okay, let's talk about a 2020 John Deere 544L wheel loader. Go for it, Tina.
We're requesting your approval to award the purchase of a 2020 John Deere 544L wheel loader to John Deere Care of Jesco Incorporated in the amount of $139,825.91. Sourcewell awarded John Deere a competitive contract for equipment through a competitively bid process. This is a replacement that will be used by the Roads Department. It will replace a 2008 John Deere 544J loader. The used John Deere loader will be traded in on the new purchase, and the amount is within the adopted budget.
As Tina
said, the loader installed?
Yes, this is one of the loaders they use for construction projects, and it also goes in salt. This particular loader, a few years ago, we had to put a hydraulic valve on. It cost us approximately $14,000. That did not take care of the other rust issues, so we are now looking to trade it in. John Deere has offered us $54,000 for our trade-in, and this machine we are actually buying with a bucket scale so we can weigh salt when we load the trucks, not only for MDE reporting, but also to make sure we don't overload our trucks.
Well, I move that the Board of Commissioners award the purchase of the 2020 John Deere 544L wheel loader to John Deere, care of Jesco Inc. in the amount of $139,825.91.
Second.
Okay, got a motion and second. Seeing and hearing no discussion. All in favor? Okay, we got four. That's unanimous. I think, Tina, you're now off, right?
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Mr. Vogel, thank you. And hopefully, once equipment comes in, I'll be happy to come down and look at it. I used to play with little trucks like that when I was a kid. It's neat stuff.
You want to come over and test it out? I'll let you know.
Okay, from Commissioner Bob the Builder, we're done with that. Now let's talk about FY 2021 pavement testing and rehab recommendations. Doug? Or Chris, who's on it?
So good morning, commissioners. We are before you this morning, and I'm gonna let Chris get into the detail. We come before you on an annual basis, and this year is for our FY 2021. Pavement testing and rehabilitation recommendations, easy for me to say. So the Department of Public Works Bureau of Engineering is seeking approval to use an existing bid term contract. And I'm gonna let Chris give you the entire scoop on Wood Environment and Infrastructure Solutions. Chris.
Thank you, good afternoon. As Doug said, we're here to seek your concurrence to utilize an existing bid term contract with Wood Environment and Infrastructure Solutions Incorporated to evaluate and provide pavement testing and rehabilitation recommendations for about 42 miles of roadway in the amount of $109,623.48. These are the roadways that we are planning for the FY21 paving projects. The consultant will be providing us with a visual condition survey, some non-destructive testing, pavement coring, material sampling, and subgrade soil classification. Laboratory testing of the subgrade soils when necessary, and then our final report with our pavement rehabilitation recommendations. We received two proposals from our term contractors. Wood was the lowest proposal, and they included a 10% discount, as they called it, for COVID-19 reasons to help us along. The other firm's proposal was more than $120,000 more than Wood's proposal. We've utilized this firm for several years for the same service, and we anticipate the final report to be to us in November of 2020.
That's pretty impressive of a vendor really wanting to keep the customer. So kudos to them for thinking outside, and especially in these challenging times. So pretty impressive.
We were very pleased.
So the other vendor was over twice what this estimate is?
That's correct. The other vendor has not done this work before. I think maybe they trying to cover some things that they're not familiar with. They've done similar work in other jurisdictions, but maybe not in ours. So I think they had some unknowns. They also had some subcontractors involved, which Wood does not. Wood does everything in-house.
Mr. Lenochin, can you explain to the public the long-term benefit of making this investment as a county?
So this will provide us our recommendations for next year's paving projects, whether or not we reclaim a road, whether or not we mill and overlay a road, or whether or not we just overlay the road. It also will help us understand what's underneath the asphalt, the foundation of the roadway, so that we don't go in and maybe mill off 2 inches. And then when we go to put the paver or the heavy trucks that they sink, we have all that information about the foundation of what's under the road, so we can make the right pavement recommendations for next year.
So long term, this is actually going to help save us money and plan better.
It does. It's our process of getting the right product for the right solution for our long term benefit for our roadway rehabilitation projects.
Yeah, commissioners, just to add in, I was out last week with our engineering bureau in all facets. And what Chris has said, just last week, I toured 3 different sites that we're managing, all related to asphalt. One was a complete full depth reclamation where we go down, have to grind it up and put everything back and then put asphalt on top. Another one was a 2-inch and 2-inch mill and fill where we mill 2 inches off and then just lay 2 inches back. And then the other, was an overlay project that was going on. So we're always fiscally conservative, and there is no better time than in the problems that we're going through right now. This way we can accurately prioritize what we bring to you as a board and allow you to make those tough decisions, regarding the finances that you have to do. So this is an excellent project to keep going.
I appreciate this, and that helps us with our decision.
Well, what I was just going to say is you don't make it that difficult. It was a very good rundown on figuring out ways to become more efficient, especially in the long term. So I appreciate that. Thad, do I hear a motion?
I move the Board of Commissioners authorize the Department of Public Works to utilize the term contract with Wood Environmental and Infrastructure Solutions Incorporated in the amount of $109,623.48.
Second.
Okay, I got a motion and a second. Any discussion? Seeing and hearing none, all in favor? That is unanimous. Okay, gentlemen, thanks. And thanks again for the update on that. Okay, Campbell, Jack Brown, let's talk about Keystone Public Safety annual renewal of service support agreement. Okay, I see Jack, I see Scott, go for it.
Thank you, Commissioner. This is an annual agreement with Keystone Public Safety. They are our computer dispatch or CAD vendor. This is an expected and budgeted expense. It is in line with what was expected. We simply do not have the authority to execute it. It's in the amount of $184,252. And again, this is to provide a full gamut of support of our computer dispatch, which includes our field mobile application, 24/7, 365 support, et cetera.
This must be important because it looks like Jack's at Deep Creek Lake or something on vacation, and he's coming right here to talk to us about this today. Appreciate that, Jack.
Commissioner, thank you for pointing that out. This is at least the third, Jack, or fourth time that he has been willing to join us, even though he is out in Western Maryland on a well-deserved vacation.
Okay, Jack, do you have anything to add to it?
I don't, Commissioner. Thank you.
Okay. Gentlemen, any other discussion? Do I hear a motion?
I'll make the motion that the Board of Commissioners authorize the Director of Public Safety to execute the proposed FY 2020 2021 agreement with Keystone Public Safety Inc. and pay the bill.
Second.
Okay, got a motion and second. Any further discussion? Seeing, hearing none. All in favor? Okay, 4 unanimous. Thank you, gentlemen. Go back to fishing, Jack. Enjoy your vacation.
Oh,
okay, let's talk about self-contained breathing apparatus with our newest director. Bob McCoy should be on somewhere. And Valerie and Scott, and I think Bob joined us.
I thought, he's on here.
He is. He popped in, popped out.
There
he is. Okay, gentlemen, you're up.
Hey, Commissioner, I'd like to recognize one other gentleman who took the time to join us. Mr. Tom Coe, you should see him somewhere on your screen. I don't know if he's, there he is.
There he is. Hey, Tom, how's it going?
Tom is in one of his many capacities that he assists with the county. He's also he is, among other things, a member of the leadership core group of the county's all-volunteer hazard materials team. And he's gracious enough to join us today in case you have specific questions. This too should be a rather straightforward effort. The request is for the commissioners to authorize the purchase of 3 SCBA self-contained breathing apparatus that are unique to the needs of the hazardous materials response team. They have a higher capacity or duration, which is the nature of what Tom and his team do when they have to don and off their gear, et cetera. A lot of time is, I won't say wasted, but is expended doing those efforts before they can actually try to mitigate the reason that they're there, you know, to address the hazard at hand. Specifically, they have 10 units assigned to this team. They are in need of replacement. They have reached or actually exceeded their useful life and their ability to be recertified. So it's time to replace them. And part of that effort is today's proposal to purchase 3 of the SCBA for $36,420 using grant funds, 100% grant funds. There is no cost to the county. To Ms. Hawkins' credit, when Mr. Coe and they identified the need, they approached Valley, they worked cooperatively to be able to find these funds and be able to contribute these 3 SCBA to the effort. So we respectfully ask the commissioner's approval to proceed with the purchase.
Yes, Scott, I have to say you had me on no cost to the county.
I don't get to say that too often, Commissioner.
If no one else is going to say anything, I'll make the motion. Okay. I move the Director of Public Safety be authorized to approve the purchase of the SCBA units proposed, including proof of payment of the bill.
Second. And no cost to the county, I'll second it.
Okay, we have a motion and second. Again, Rob, welcome aboard. Nice seeing your face on this GoToMeeting. Tom, thank you so much. Just before we vote on this, Rob or Tom, do you have anything that you did want to share at this time? If so, say it now. If not, we'll vote.
I think Director Campbell summed up everything perfectly. Just know that we do have 10 units to replace. This takes care of 3 of them. So as additional grant money comes forward in the near future, you might hear this request again, but it's just to fulfill our complement of 10.
Fantastic. Okay, any discussion? Seeing, hearing none, all in favor? I see 4, that's unanimous. Gentlemen and Valerie, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Commissioner Boucher is the Double Pipe Creek boat launch. Where is Mr. Day? There he is. Okay, Mr. Daggett, let's talk about a boat launch.
Good afternoon, commissioners. Twice in one day. I'm not sure who's luckier here. Appreciate your time. We have funding approved in the FY19 and FY20 budgets for a kayak launch at Double Pipe Creek. We had some additional expenses with the design process, and then construction bids came in higher than we had anticipated. So we are requesting, we need an additional $50,200 to complete the project. Program Open Space supports 90% of the costs for this project. So we need an additional $5,020 transferred from Recreation and Parks unallocated into this project so that we could move forward with the bid award. I'm happy to answer any questions you all may have.
Well, you know, Mr. Tom Coe is a kayaker as well, but he just took off. Yeah, I'm glad this project's moving forward. I've always been checking on it. I'm looking forward to it, and I'm going to make the motion. I move that the Board of County Commissioners approve the transfer of $5,020 from Rec and Parks unallocated number 9139 to Double Pipe Creek Park number 8773 to meet the required match for program open space funding to support completion of the project.
Second.
Okay, motion second. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor? That's 4-0. Now let's now we transferred it. Let's spend the money. So, Jeff or Maureen, go for it.
Yes, we're here to ask your approval to award this bid to HMF Paving Contractors. They're out of Frederick, Maryland, for the amount of $97,500.
Anything special about the paving of this?
We have a set of stairs, and then we have a ramp that basically is located in between two sets of stairs for raising or lowering your kayak down to the water. And there's a concrete platform at the base of this. It's a challenging work site, and also you're limited by permits as far as when the work can actually be accomplished because you're working in the stream area. So we're not able to get in there prior to June 1st. So it does push the construction schedule that way.
So this site will be so senior friendly, so to speak?
A heck of a lot easier than it is to get down there now, but I'll tell you that.
Yes, Eric, you'll be able to use it.
Well, with that said, I move the Board of Commissioners award the contract for the boat launch at Double Pipe Creek Park to HMF Paving Contractors, Inc. in the amount of $97,500 and no cents.
Second.
Okay, got a motion second. Any further discussion? Seeing, hearing none, all in favor? Okay, Steve, you voting on this? Did you give me a thumb? Abstention? Okay, 4-1 abstention. We're good to go.
And thank you.
Absolutely. Thank you, Maureen.
Thank you very much.
I think that is all of our items. I think we're now on open admin. So I will hand it happily back over to Mr. Wance.
What happened? You're ahead of schedule. What's going on? Hey, just a few quick things I wanted to jump on here. The call's not over yet, but there's a couple important things I wanted to share with all of you from what we heard today. We heard from the health director, the acting health director now, because as most of you know, Fran Phillips retired. So she's now off to greener pastures, I would think. So we heard from them, but and then we also heard from Travis Nelson from the Maryland State Police, and in reference to the compliance efforts that we're going to be making across the state. And then we also heard from Secretary Schultz on our economic outlook. So really quick, I know we've had a long day. Secretary Schultz brought up some good items, just so everybody should know these things. Right now, unemployment rate in Maryland, we are 3 points below the national average, and we are the lowest in the mid-Atlantic states. So that's a good sign. There seems to be a steady rise, albeit small, but a steady rise in consumer spending. And we're also seeing tourism numbers gradually increase as well. So all of those things are positive signs for the state of Maryland. The state of Maryland is beginning their Masks on Maryland campaign. And that is starting up. They've got a couple Ravens players that are gonna be doing some great efforts there. They've got Orioles manager, Brandon Hyde, who's gonna be talking about masks. And the theme for the Masks on Maryland campaign is only you can keep Maryland open for business. So I've got the instructions on how we can tag onto that, because once again, Carroll County was out in front of the mass campaign thing. And when I chirped up, they are very interested in hearing what we did. So I'm going to be in touch with Chris Weinbrenner and share what we've done, which they really appreciate. So Masks on Maryland campaign is starting. And again, Ravens, Orioles, a lot of folks getting on board that that effort, which is great. And finally, as a result, we heard from Travis Nelson. We're going to start this compliance group, and we're going to meet on that next week, as I told you guys earlier today. But Maryland is also going to be instituting a 24-hour tip line beginning 9 a.m. on Monday. So if you're out and about and you see a business that is not complying, you'll be able to call the tip line, and then they'll get that to the right county so that it can be enforced or what have you. Now, they made a huge emphasis on saying, look, they're not out here to throw people in jail or to fine them. This is mainly going to be an educational effort here to ensure that people are actually doing the right thing so that we can continue to move in the right direction here in Maryland, because, again, Maryland is doing very, very well. So everybody in the state should be applauding themselves right now, because we're doing some things that other states around us are not. So if you want to buy some bubble wrap, Weaver, to put it over the whole state, let's roll, baby. So anyway, that's where we are. I wanted to share that with you guys and gals, because that's some good news coming out of the state right now. With all that being said, vigilant and not complacent were two things that were used heavily in the call this afternoon. So that's where we are. So with that, I'll shut up. I don't know. I apologize. I wasn't on, but I think we're at the end here. Roberta, you have anything, or Ed? I'll stop there.
Due to the lateness of the hour of the morning session, we didn't review the agendas. So if you want to review the next 2 weeks' agendas, this would be a good time to do so.
Can you make that a little bit bigger, Chris, or not? There you go. And go down, if you want to go down through it with me, that would be good, because I don't have it in front of me. So the week of August the 10th, nothing on Monday the 11th. I'll be involved in an Ag Center board meeting, which they're having in person now. Everybody's 50 feet away. Everybody gets a corner in the Shipley Arena. So that's that. Wednesday the 12th, Commissioner Weaver has a Farm Museum Advisory Board meeting at 9:30 a.m. I will be involved in Maryland Association of Counties Initiative Subcommittee, a virtual meeting at 10 a.m. That's where we're getting down to what MACO is going to go after in the General Assembly this year, what they're going to focus on. And Commissioner Frazier has a long Board of Education meeting beginning at 5 p.m. on Wednesday the 12th, or maybe not so long, we'll see. All right, Thursday the 13th, we go back in open session. We're going to be doing our typical COVID updates. And as a result of the conversation this morning, we're going to add Ed Singer to that and make sure that Jeff Degetz is on so we can keep that athletic thing front and center and in our face. And then we go down to various items. We're going to get an update on the 2020 census, which I believe, by the way, Carroll County is number one. We're going to have a water and sewer amendment. I guess that's the hearing, I believe. Then we're going to request approval to proceed to hearing for the Department of Fire and Emergency Medical Services from Bob McCoy. So that's something new that is on our plates. I'm glad to see that's in front of us already. We're also going to have a purchase of portable radios and application and acceptance for the 2020 sufficiency renewal. NOFA, that's our citizen services. Child support enforcement agreement through the sheriff's office. What else? Keep going. Keep going. Keep going. Keep going. Some budget talk. Another resolution for the budget. And that's it right now. That'll probably grow. And Commissioner Rothstein has the podcast. Any additions to next week? All right, hearing none, we'll skip ahead to the week of
Commissioner, August 17th. Also be approving the Emergency Services Advisory Council bylaws.
ESAC. Yep, we're looking at ESAC. Okay, week of the 17th, on Tuesday the 18th, Commissioner Weaver. Tuesday the 18th is Commissioner Weaver's breakfast. So we're all going to meet at the Weaver Farm and have fresh eggs and sausage and stuff, right, Weaver?
You're having a virtual breakfast.
Okay, well, that doesn't.
You can look at it, but you can't touch it.
It's great for the calorie count, but it's not very satisfying.
Yeah. Right. Commissioner Rothstein has planning and zoning at 9 a.m. on Tuesday the 18th, and also council meeting is that afternoon at 2 p.m. That's Commissioners Rothstein and Weaver. Wednesday the 19th is Carroll Community College Board of Trustees meeting virtually. That's Commissioner Weaver. That's at 3 p.m. That's an interesting time. All right, Thursday we go back into open session. I believe this has changed, hasn't it, Roberta? That 9:40, is that closed? Is that correct? Yeah, that'll be closed, right?
Yeah, that's not a public meeting. You were invited to a meeting with the secretary.
Okay, so that'll be a closed meeting for us. And just think about us being in shorts with crazy t-shirts on, walking into the convention center in Ocean City, into that little room on the second floor that no one ever knows how to get to. That's what that meeting's gonna be, except we'll be on the computer screen. So that's that day. Then Thursday, again, obviously, we go into open session to include all things COVID. You can pan on down. And we've got some more rural legacy purchases, a couple there. And, yep, there's a bunch of those. Community solar development from land resource management. We're going to be talking a little bit about that. That's in the afternoon. By the way, session starts at 10:30 that day, 10:30, because we'll be in closed with Greg Slater, Secretary of Transportation. So we'll be on the air at 10:30 to those folks that are watching. Friday, that's all for the agenda items. That'll probably grow again. And Commissioner Wance has the podcast for that week. Any additions to that week, and that'll probably change too. So, all right, what else you got, Roberta? Anything else?
That was okay.
There a second? I'll second it. Why not? I'll second it. All right, good conversation today, gentlemen and ladies. I'm glad we did what we did today, so we had a good day. And I apologize for being away, but I wanted to make sure that we had some voice on that state call this afternoon. With that being said, everybody have a safe week ahead. Continue to be vigilant. Do not become complacent. If you get a chance, check out the Maryland, the Masks on Maryland campaign. That's pretty cool. They've got a couple Ravens on there. So that's pretty cool. And Orioles manager, Brandon Hyde. So for those that are following.
Not as cool as the commissioners and the rest of the county leaders.
Good point. Good point, Roberta. Good point. Yeah, that's true. Not as cool as Rothstein trying to get into a business in Sykesville that was locked. You know, not as cool as that. So, you know, just saying.
They knew he was coming.
Anyway, everybody, safety first, and we will see everybody soon. All right. We are adjourned. All in favor? Take care. Thanks.